Hey everyone, thank you for tuning in today. So today Noah and I are going to be addressing some pretty heavy stuff, pretty serious topic. So today, for once, we're not memeing you. So if you or a loved one are dealing with any struggles in your mental health, and I know you've heard this 100 times from 100 different people, but seek help. We will be putting the number for Suicide Hotline in the description. It is a necessity if it gets that far. And seek a local counselor or therapist in your area. It is worth the price of your mental sanity.
And it's never healthy to keep these things inside.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you very much. And welcome to the Undercast, hosted by Noah and Nakayo. And, well, to start this episode off, we would like to say, first off, thank you, everyone, for watching so far all of our videos.
Seventh episode,
is it?
Seventh episode.
I lose track.
If you've noticed, we're trying to fix the thumbnail from the two black bars on the side. Really, that bothered me more than anything.
Yeah,
consistency is key.
Didn't even notice it.
I'm working on creating an actually completely new thumbnail as we work into a possible unofficial season 2 or whatever.
Indeed.
So, here, I'm going to let Noah have the floor, mostly.
Well, today, guys, we're going to be delving into some personal stuff, unfortunately. It's that time of year where everybody kind of has that seasonal depression where they get down and, you know, everybody gets a bit manic and so on. And so I decided that, you know, maybe this episode we should do something a bit more grounded and a bit more serious and talk about some of the ramifications of mental health, what it can do to you when it goes unchecked. The effects of on the people around you of suicide and the reasons you need to get help.
Is there anything? And I mean, the fact that it is that season also coincides with it being the anniversary of a event in Noah's life that is also the second big reason for this episode being uploaded. It should be uploaded Tuesday?
Tuesday, December 18th.
Which is exactly the 1 year anniversary. That's why we're doing an early episode this week, not on Thursday. So apologize for the break in inconsistency, but
Sorry about that, folks. But tomorrow will be the marking of the 1 year anniversary of my father's suicide, and so we deemed it an important topic to discuss mental health and why you should seek help if you're not doing okay.
Yeah, and I mean, this year I had a huge bout over the summer of my own mental health insanely depleting and straining, and it got to the point where I did actually have to see a therapist, later a psychiatrist, to see what was wrong, I guess, chemically. But it is just, I mean, obviously I don't want to overstep or overshadow my experience, but I'm just saying it is very much worth it to go and seek asylum, not like asylum,
not in
safety,
seek safety,
not insane asylum. Yeah, don't. Well, I mean, they've changed since the early, you know, 20th century.
Yeah, but just a little bit. You know, they don't incarcerate you for being gay anymore.
Yeah. You know, it's almost like it's not actually a mental illness.
Yeah, it's almost,
huh? Almost. Yeah. Well, I'll let you have the heavy burden.
All right. Well, last year, man, this is going to be rough to start off. I didn't plan the story out at all. I'm going to keep it real with you, Chief, but...
Well, I mean, it's not something that really is able to be planned, I don't think, or should be, maybe.
Yes, but my memory tends to fail me at certain times.
Yeah, that's fair.
So, last year, it was a rough year for me. My parents were going through a divorce. Me and my mother, my little brother, were living at my uncle's house, and I gotta say thank you for giving us the shelter and the home we needed at the time for that, because you probably provided a better home than most could during those times. And we were living there, and I had been going back and forth between my father and my mother every week on Sunday. I'd gone back and forth because that was that was what they agreed in court and so on. And I guess things just weren't going exactly the way my father planned. He lost control of this situation that was going on, And he started drinking and smoking to cope with these things, which is also, guys, one of the worst coping mechanisms you could use for any mental illness.
No matter what we say about coffee
alternatives. No matter what we say about coffee and its healthy alternatives. Drinking, smoking, drugs, anything like that. Escaping reality through unnatural means, and yes, drugs are unnatural means, even if it does come from the earth, you're altering your mind state.
I mean, obviously, if they're FDA approved, but
if they're medically,
well, even that can be abused, obviously. Yeah. What I think what good psychiatrists do, a good psychiatrist will test your blood, see what you'll react to best and not, and then decide from there what type of drug will help you chemically. Yeah. But not the drugs that
Noah's referring to. Not hardcore cocaine and stuff like that. So anyway, he was drinking and smoking weed. And I remember the last time I saw him, my house reeked of it. I didn't see him. I talked to him through a closed door because he was high and drunk and he couldn't come and say goodbye to me. And that was the last time I talked to him. So imagine my surprise when Monday of December 18th rolls around and it's just about to be my finals week and I get a horrifying call from my mother saying, Noah, if your father calls, don't go with him, and if you see him, run the other way. Now, obviously, I didn't know what was going on. I'm a sophomore and I'm scared. I was scared. But I muscled through it because that's what any kid in my situation really has to do. They don't have a choice. And my uncle got me from school, and we got my little brother, and I gave my little brother my JBLs. I had JBLs at the time instead of Beats, but I gave my
little... They're better than Beats.
No, bro. They're not. Oh, no, I don't even have Beats. I have Bose. Bose.
Oh, I was going to say, they're so much better than Beats. Are you kidding me? When you're afraid of Bose.
Bose beats Beats.
Back on topic.
Back onto the topic. Bose.
You gave Jesse your...
I gave Jesse my insuperior JBLs.
They're not as good as Bose.
They're not as good as Bose. And he was blasting music in the back, having a good old time. And I was talking to my uncle. I'm like, what's going on? He's like, your dad, he's gone off the edge. He threatened suicide. And that means that, the police told us to hide you because if he's going over the deep end like this, he might be going postal and he might try to take the family with him. It's not unheard of. And I went, wow, it's not. So we went and we stayed at my church for a while. And I think probably an hour passed and my little brother was sitting in the back seat, jamming out. And I was sitting in the front seat just listening to music and waiting, relaxing. And my uncle comes out and he looks at me. And he's messed up. I was like,
Seeing David Heath messed up is a very rare sighting.
Yes, extremely. That's my uncle. So he walked out and he sat in the car, and he looked at me, and he went, he did it, and he was teary eyed and he couldn't keep it back. And I went, what do you mean? And he said, your dad, he shot himself, and he started crying, and I did. And my little brother couldn't hear us because he was in the back seat with his headphones on. So he's that happened, and I didn't even understand. I was confused. I was angry. I was hurt. I didn't understand. And the whole car ride home, I couldn't let my little brother know yet, so I had to hold back those tears and that pain just for him, because my mother wanted to be the one to tell him. So we all sat at my uncle's house just waiting for anything. We waited for a few hours until my mother came home and she told us, yeah, he did it. And he told us, and she told us, I want to be the one to tell Jesse, and she did. And I remember all the people that showed up that night to be there for us. It was very nice of everyone that showed up. But my point is, nobody saw this coming. Nobody. We all knew he needed help. There was no doubt about it. He wasn't stable in the sense of issues with anger and so on and so forth, but nobody could have seen the issue that really lied below. He didn't want to live. Nobody knew. So I guess my point here to you is, if there are people and they plan on doing something like this, you're not going to know about it until it happens, and it may be too late at that point. So make sure that you take care of your friends and your family and tell them you love them. Make sure you're looking out for signs, and if you need help, please don't stop yourself from saying anything, because all you're going to do is hurt the people around you. You're not going to solve any problems. Suicide's just a permanent answer to a temporary problem, and it's unnecessary. It goes to the extreme. And most people, if you've heard suicide stories, most people, after they've tried to commit suicide and their attempt failed, they regret it. They say they regret their attempt and they're ashamed of it because they were just depressed for the time and the moment. So that can, I promise you, things can change. People can get better. You just need to seek help. There's no shame in asking for help. Believe it or not, there's no shame in asking for help. No one is going to judge you for not being okay. And if they do, then they shouldn't be in your life. And you should find people that care.
Well, that's the mistake I made. You gotta, like he said, I could look at his dad, and obviously he's gonna be different when I come over than versus when strictly with the family. But even Noah obviously probably couldn't have seen that coming, and but he didn't. And I guess you don't really look at people and think anything more than what they appear to be at the time.
Exactly.
Now you're gonna, obviously everyone looks at and sees Snapchat stories and Instagram stories, and they're like, oh my gosh, and there's these huge paragraphs, and they're yeah. crying for attention. But that doesn't, and we all look at that and think, oh my gosh, just stop. But in some people's, you know, mind, that is a cry for help, being attention grabbing. But a lot of the time when this stuff happens, you don't hear anything about it. It all boils down to a huge head because everything's been suppressed for so long, and then it rears itself at the last moment when it's too late, and it affects everybody.
Yeah,
that's not an understatement. I'm a firm believer in the butterfly effect, not in the sense of a butterfly flaps its wing and causes a hurricane, but I am in you know, obviously it's an irrefutable fact that things lead to other things, and so when somebody removes their existence from the earth, as a living soul, as a being, everybody is affected. Now, I think that even expanded more than we affect others more than we will ever see.
Yeah, definitely. Because there's a lot of people that I didn't even know I had an impact on until they told me, wow, Noah, you know, this day, just because you did this thing, it changed everything. And I had no clue for that. And all these people you see, they're crying out for attention on Instagram. It may not be attention, you know, that could legitimately and genuinely be their only way of getting things out.
Well, attention's a tool.
Yeah.
You need somebody to hear you.
Yeah, and if you don't, then it'll hurt you in ways you couldn't in ways you can imagine. Being alone, there's not much that's worse than just truly being alone, and I mean that.
Oh, I know that.
Yeah,
we both do.
Yeah, and it's some people, they social media, they just, that's their only way of coping with things, and it's sad, but it's true.
People say face-to-face and human interaction has gotten worse since the introduction of social media, and I'm also a firm believer in history repeats itself. In the 50s, it was shunned upon for anybody to have a mental illness, and you didn't tell people that, you kept it hidden. Nowadays, we are fine telling people, but it's shunned to show that side of you on Instagram or Facebook.
Well, it's
it all repeats itself in one way or another.
It's almost like some people are competing just to see who has the worst problems.
Who has the worst life?
Yeah.
Some people, it's either one or the other, though. It's I have the best life or I have the worst life.
And more often than not, you're going to hear I have the worst
life. I have the worst life. Oh my gosh, I'm stressed by this, this, and that. What can I do? And with that, I think we as humans intake everything we see and we hear. We're the most stoic human is more perceptive than a lot of animals. And animals do it from instinct. We do it because we react in a society to what people say. And when all that you're seeing and all that you're inputting into your mind is trash and garbage on social medias and everyone saying I have the worst life, that was one of the catalysts for me during this time in my life a little bit ago. Became completely desensitized to a huge amount of the world, and still am dealing with that because I let myself intake all of that bullshit. I let myself look at it and I let myself fester upon it, get triggered, and get mad because I see all this garbage and negativity.
Yeah.
And your dad, in fact, impacted a lot of that in my own psyche. I sat there for a long time, for months after it happened, and I would have these bouts of time where I'd be thinking, how could that happen? Who is able to control all of these things? And I gained a very, very unhealthy existential nihilistic point of view on things, and that drove me very much into a large depression. So like Noah says, everything affects everything. You are, and I was just talking about this on the ride home when we were picking up Noah's little brother from school, and he was saying something about so a lot of the times I feel like a mistake, and I was like, well, no, nobody, well, first of all, you are planned, so yeah, you can't, but even, obviously, those who are planned, you are not a mistake. You are so influential in the grand scheme of how everything plays out. If you've ever seen It's a Wonderful Life, it's a Christmas movie, or a period movie that takes place during Christmas, there's a man on the verge of killing himself. He meets an angel, and this movie's filmed back in the 50s, I think. And he meets an angel, and the angel is trying to get him to, first of all, believe that he's an angel, because the main character just thinks he's gone crazy and he's seeing crap. And two, he's going to try to show him what this whole town where he grew up in would be like if he'd never been born.
I heard this Christmas story. I don't remember the name of it, but I know what you're talking about.
It's a Wonderful Life, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I remember that. It hit me deep.
And that was an old movie where obviously they didn't mathematically look at everything he did, but even right. The little things, a few, just a handful, they picked maybe four different things that he'd done throughout his life, things that normal everyday humans can do and do all the time, literally changed the entire infrastructure of the town. His brother that he saved when he was a young child, his brother Harry, if he hadn't been born or alive to even save his little brother went on to fight in World War II, save an entire convoy from Nazi pilots. And those were thousands of men. He won the Medal of Honor in that movie. And the main character, played by Jimmy Stewart, if any of you know who that old actor is, he never went on to fight in the war because he had to stay back at home and run his father's old bonds business, and he felt like nothing. He felt like he wasn't doing everything that his brother was doing. If he hadn't been there to originally save him, he is the reason that his brother went on to save that whole convoy of men. See, wow. Things that everyday humans do, pulling your brother out of an icy river. Wow, you just saved his life. Now he's going to go on to get the Medal of Honor.
Yeah.
And think about reversing that. What happens when somebody dies? Not just dies, kills themselves. What does that do?
It destroys lives, guys. It really does. In ways we couldn't even think about. There's just so many factors to take into account. So many things, so many people you don't even realize you're affecting. It's better to reach out and get help.
Yeah. Like I said, I didn't.
Yeah.
Obviously, Noah's father didn't.
Yeah.
It took somebody, a good friend of mine, finally telling my parents about my plan to off myself, that it finally got to the point where they took it like very, very good, responsible parents should. Not punish your child, but get them help.
Who's gonna punish their child?
There are surprisingly a lot of friends and people I've met that are our age that have gone to attempt suicide or started cutting, and their parents found out and they grounded the crap out of them. They took everything they had away.
Exactly is that gonna solve?
You're asking the wrong person. My parents took it like responsible human beings. All right, fair did the enough. Right thing fair and enough. Got me help. The thing that, I mean, would you, here's a good question. Why do you think your father didn't ask for help?
Why do I think? I think he was too prideful. I think he was too full of himself and he was too closed shut to ask anyone for help. He was too, he didn't want to open up because he was worried about what people might think, I guess, or he was insecure and he just couldn't bring himself to do it.
I think it's a lot of those things. I think together. It's,
yeah. Also, I definitely think that the weed and the alcohol, antidepressants, you mix them together with whatever medication he had been taking, because I know he had a lot of different medications for a lot of physical things. They probably blended in such a way that gave him problems. And there's no doubt about it that he had a chemical imbalance of some sort. For the way that he acted and the things that he did, I can't even entirely be angry at him, because part of it wasn't his fault. And that's the thing, guys. Part of it, it's not your fault. It's not your fault that you feel...
Exactly.
Yeah, it's not your fault. So it shouldn't be something that you're embarrassed about to go talk to people because you need help. It's not you. Something's affecting you in a way that's destroying you.
Yeah, that was the point I had to reach, was it wasn't my fault. It wasn't your dad's. I even think you were talking to me about this, almost a theory you guys had, that he had done all the work and all the time he spent working was to get the funds to take his children to college and pay for them to have a good life. But in doing so, in sacrificing his time with his kids for work, it destroyed his relationship with his kids. It destroyed his connection to reality, which is another large reason why he did what he did. We were thinking.
Well, the way my mother told me is, it's a fact. It's not really, well, most of it's a fact, and some of it's speculation.
I didn't want to come out and say that it was all fact. I just thought it was.
Yeah, but the way my mother told me it was that my father wanted to be a father more than anything in the world. He really did. And then he had to get a job in corporate America to keep his family afloat. Now, I wasn't even born yet, but it was just him, my mom, and my older brother who were living in New York. So that gives you an idea of the prices. So he had to get a job in corporate America. Actually, no, he worked in the stock market, keeping computers up so that they didn't crash. Because if they crashed, they lost millions and millions of dollars in seconds. So he told me it was the most stressful thing he could possibly be doing in the world. And those words came from my father himself. But my mother told me that's what led him into drinking so heavily, was to cope with that stress. And ultimately, I think that's what set him down the path, was an unhealthy coping mechanism through drinking. But beyond that, in getting into more things that probably contributed, was he wanted to be a father more than anything, and he had to get this job in corporate America to be able to pay for us. And because he got this job to pay for us and actually allow us to live good and healthy lives, he never had time to spend with us. He'd work, he'd wake up early, he'd come home late, and then he'd drink and pass out because he was so stressed. And then it just became a habit from there on out. And so he never had the time to spend with us, so he resented us in a way. And that's why he was so angry all the time. And we think that's definitely part of the reason of the thing that contributed to his passing.
Another line of proof that the butterfly effect does to exactly work to a point that theory is proven true again. Like, it was everything. It started as, I need to do everything that I can for my family, but in doing so, the irony of the whole situation was, I'm going to destroy my family.
Yeah, yeah.
Is that not Shakespearean?
It is.
I mean, effect, cause and effect is more of a web than it is a chain.
Yeah.
Think of a food web, a food chain, you know, there's one line of animals, and then the food web expands, and everything is affected once one variable is added or taken away. An ecosystem dies or it thrives. It is birthed or it's put to its end. It's beautiful, and in a way, we're all helpless to it. But if we think of it less as, you know, we're destined to just not know if this decision is going to cause heartache and destruction, and instead we look at it as every morning when we wake up, I am going to do my best to keep my link within this this web as strong and as positive as possible. And that doesn't mean that you're not going to have days that you just absolutely shat on people, and you know, you're a bully when you're driving, or you go to work and you take out your anger on your coworkers, your wife, your friends, and you're gonna do that. But the goal is to try to keep your mind, think of it as like a filter. Yeah. See, what are you inputting? Is it going to be used as fuel to put back out, you know, not just positivity, but life.
Yeah.
Am I going to breathe? If I'm going to breathe in life, I'm going to exhale at least something of derived from that. If I'm going to input death, sadness, depression, loneliness, what do you think I'm going to exhale then?
Yeah, honestly, guys. And you just got to stay strong out there for us, for your family. And I would like to quote Chris Pratt when I say, there is a God and he loves you and he has a plan for you. Even if you don't love him or acknowledge his existence, there is a God and he loves you guys. Yeah. And I mean that. I really do.
That's big facts, you know? I mean, and anybody, obviously, you choose what you want to believe in, and not just in religious or scientific terms. I mean that you need to choose what you stand for.
Yeah.
In everything, in every single thing, in every single venture you take in life, you need to know that you're doing this because you stand for it.
If you stand for nothing, Burr, what'll you fall for?
Everything, man.
Exactly.
So, I mean, if you try to proceed in life and you have no, not moral compass, but you have no driving factor, you're going to be an empty shell, like an NPC almost. You're going to be... And there are some people, I swear, that legitimately are NPCs.
Yeah.
There are people at our school that are just absolute robots. And it saddens me, and it makes me lose my faith in humanity. I think that's also a really difficult part. The majority of people see all the crap that's happening right now. They're banning Baby It's Cold Outside from the radio because of overly sensitive human beings, and I'm not going to go into an argument on that, but any like decent person can look outside and be easily depressed by all of the crap that's going on around us. Yeah. And it's easy to inhale that. Just keep strong.
All right, guys, so we're getting towards the end here, but I want to leave you with a few things that helped me get through hard times that I've given to people that have also been going through hard times. And the few things I want to say is, one, Nikai has been saying it the entire podcast, you receive the energy that you give off. So if you give off a negative energy and a negative, you know, you're
it
like
works vice versa.
Yeah, moping and depressed, you're going to get back moping and depressed. But if you give off a positive vibe, you don't even have to be happy. Just a positive, willing to help, loving, caring vibe, you're going to get that back. Because then people, they're going to love and care about you when you show that you love and care about them. And it's exerting, guys. Let me tell you.
And you may think that's actually cliche, but the funny thing is, it's the complete opposite. We're saying the opposite of what a lot of people would say. Not the whole, don't be depressed.
Yeah.
But everyone says that. But we're legitimately telling you to breathe love into people.
Yeah.
Not, you know...
We're
not cope. Don't go out there and cope.
Yes.
Love and live, breathe life.
Yes. Because we're not telling you can't be depressed, because it's not a choice, unfortunately.
Yeah.
It's not a choice.
It really isn't, and it's not your fault.
Yes, it's not. So be better than the people around you. Don't even make the jokes, the suicide jokes, the self-harm, that I'm going to kill myself.
Yeah,
first
don't.
Off, you could not get a more unfunny and unoriginal joke, I gotta say.
It really
it's
is.
So it's just dumb. But if even if you just stop with the jokes and you push people to be better, you say, hey guys, you know, we can be better than these jokes, you know, you shouldn't want to kill yourself.
And he's speaking because he actually says this stuff. He's not just practicing what he preaches. Noah legitimately does this stuff way better of a man than I do. But
hey, no.
No, I'm just saying, like, you practice what you preach. You as Noah, as an individual, don't do what a lot of other people do and say one thing and then go do the other. You Ooh. Actually do it.
Well, I don't wholeheartedly... I don't believe that I can wholeheartedly give someone advice and truthfully mean it without having, like, done the thing myself, you know?
Yeah. You have to know... For you to give advice, you actually have to know what you're talking about.
Yeah, that's why I'm telling you guys, you know. I've been in this situation where you said, obviously I had my lows with, you know, family trauma and stuff like that. I'm just telling you, you are going to be, there are times where you're going to be depressed. And you know what? That's okay. But keep positive, guys. Just make sure you're not making stupid jokes about it. And just... consistently strive to be better than you are, and don't just wallow in sadness.
You don't like the world? Well, then don't be it.
Yeah.
You hate everything that's going on at school and whatever, and the crap people are saying, the crap that's happening, that's just so unbelievably small that people are making huge deals about in the streets and just being absolute horrid people. Reverse racism, sexism, homophobia. Just don't be that.
Yes. Don't.
Do not be that.
Don't be
loving.
Don't be the negativity.
If you don't agree with somebody's belief,
sadness.
Then don't say that. I mean, be loving. There's nothing worse than somebody who will say, well, it's not like I don't agree with you, but just shut up.
Yeah.
Just speak love, speak life. It's going to go a hell of a long way if you shut your mouth and listen than it is to talk sometimes.
Yeah. And like Witt Lowry said, if you want the change, you have to be the change. And he's absolutely right on that front, guys. Now, we're running on a little long, so we're going to have to get going. But I want to thank all of you for listening this far. And really, if you're having any issues, you can reach out to me.
I got you, B.
Or Nikayo. And we would be willing to listen to what you have to say if it means saving a life. We're also going to put the suicide hotline down in the number
in
below.
The description.
But guys, just don't be afraid to talk if that's what you need to do. Don't be afraid to be you. Is what I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
And really, if you need just some pick-me-up music because you're feeling down in the moment, I'm telling you, Witt Lowry is the way to go. I'll leave a few song names
in
down
the description.
There because, you know, there's a few songs where you just listen to it and you just get that smile on your face and you're ready to go. Well, guys, thank you for tuning in, and we hope you have a wonderful night. And,
see you guys later. See you next week. So get on up now, go get out there. Face
not defined by how hard we fall. So dust yourself off and stand tall. Cause you can make it, of this I'm sure. Just spread your wings and you will soar.
I know.